Hi guys, follow me on Instagram to never ever miss any of my crazy updates. Hi guys and welcome to another vlog. I'm driving this. This is actually the Mahindra Bolero, the BS6 model. As you can see, this car has got minor changes. Now it meets BS6 emission norms. It also meets crash norms and oh my god, this is so heavy. You know what? It doesn't flex all the way because that is what is actually blocking it from going all the way till the windscreen. There's insulation right there which doesn't work at all. That is the engine, of course. Let's put this down. So this car now actually complies with BS6 emission norms. Oh, that's the Thar. That looks really nice. And it also complies with pedestrian norms. It also complies with crash test norms. In fact, it's the first vehicle to comply with pedestrian norms with a, yes, you guessed it right, metal bumper. This is an X-shaped bumper, which has a hole here for reasons best known to Mahindra. The horn is right there on the outside. Okay, the design is not inspiring at all here. But you know what? It has got static bending lights. What does that mean? Actually, cornering function on the lights. It's got fog lamps as well. And you can see the lights, they don't look that great. But the car itself doesn't look that great. People call it the Desi G-Wagon. They really need to go to the optician to get themselves checked because this is not even close to the G-Wagon in any regard whatsoever. Because firstly, it's very narrow at the front, it's very boxy, there's no design element as such on this car, and the lights are not bright at night. That's another disappointing part. Okay, I will tell you there are some good bits about the car, like it is sub 4 meter in length, so you save some taxes, and it's a 7 seater as well, but you can actually only seat 0 people in comfort. Now, the wheels on this car happen to be 215-75-15. What are you saying 55 as this is not a sports car? You get wheel caps here, weird design of the wheel caps. Okay, you can see fit finish is very rough on this car. There's plenty of space here. You can see the suspension as well. Ground clearance is ample. You get a side footstep. You get all this, you know, graphics on the side. The outside rear view mirrors are not internally adjustable. You have to adjust them from the outside. You obviously get an antenna which is manually adjustable. But you know what, audio quality is so poor that I actually decided to just keep it down. Now the height is generous, but the width is not, and there's, I don't know what, trees fallen or whatnot. I don't understand what is this treatment. Now, this is for the fuel lid. Why am I even mentioning it? I will tell you in a bit. So in terms of design, the Bolero is kind of aged so much now that they really need to go back to the drawing board. Okay, you get a tailgate mounted spare wheel, you get a footstep there. There is the exhaust, a real exhaust, not a fake one. You can see the leaf springs on the car. Yeah. Body on frame platform, of course. It gets rear parking sensors. I've never heard them at all somehow. Okay, lights get the clear lens treatment. Obviously, no LED on this vehicle. And, you know, the hinges are very rudimentary. Meanwhile, you get a rear wiper washer. You get a high-mounted stop lamp. Let's open this because in the last two, you get jump seats for two people you hate the most in life because there's no space on offer. Okay, let's do one thing. Let's open this. Yeah, this is actually for children. There's no comfort on offer. Under-thigh support is poor. There's no headroom here either. And the legs of two people will rub here, which is kind of weird. Jack is placed right there. You don't even need to take effort. It just closes on its own. There is no stop mechanism on the tailgate either. Okay, I don't understand. What is this vent? This is fake AF. However, this is the reason why I was mentioning that there is a fuel lid cover on the other side. There is one here also. This doesn't open. This is just to make it, you know, aesthetically pleasing, or what do you call it? Symmetrical as such. All right. You can see the hinges everywhere. Let's get into the rear. First and foremost, let me tell you, rear seat space is also very, very poor. There's no legroom on offer as such. There are no door pockets here because people can't sit in here. So what will they do with the door pockets? They can't keep anything at all. But getting in is easy because you obviously get a side footstep. Okay, they have not given a center headrest because people, other than the one sitting on the side, other than four people in this car, others don't have a head because there you also don't get headrest on the jump seats. There's a center armrest right there. Floor is almost flat. Three people will not be comfortable. Although seat squab is fine enough, that's why under thigh support is decent. Headroom is also decent enough, but knee room and leg room is not that great. There's a handle to hold on to, which is very essential because you need it to hold on to dear life. But the seatbelt mechanism is the funniest I have ever seen in any car, which I will show you in a bit. There are no seatbelts for the last row people. I told you, these are the people you hate the most. But there's a handle and obviously you can lock and unlock. And this press down and pull. For what do you press down and pull that thing? No idea. Exposed wiring on the high-mounted stop lamp. The dashboard design is again very plain and basic as such. Now I'll show you the seatbelt funny thing, okay? Okay, this is the seatbelt of the car, yeah? It is so long, like I don't know what is this. Maybe, you know, you go to the gym and you have these elastic ropes for doing some exercise. Yeah, this is for the same. Why doesn't it auto pull? This is baffling for a car which costs 10.7 lakhs on road Mumbai. this could have been way better. Now, seats are not comfortable either. That's another problem. The front seats are extremely narrow. The car doesn't have any features as such. You see, exposed hinges. G-Wagon. Okay, it says powered by M-Hawk D75 right there. Yeah, this is the indicator on the side as well. And too much of boxiness going on around this car. That said, you know, you can't really complain about the design because people actually like this design. They dig this design. I don't even know why they dig this design. Now, when you open the door, you see, this strap again will remind you of the G-Wagon. No power window controls. In fact, door pockets at the front are there, which is a big feature as such. But obviously, they're very small. This is the tire pressure monitoring system. Just kidding. It just tells you tire information, like what is the air pressure you need to maintain. And you know what? Okay, some exposed bits here and there. Very rudimentary a car, very okay. There's no proper dead pedal, only forget proper. Okay, there's a dummy button here, start stop system button, and this is for the headlight leveler. Eliminated key ring in this car. Let's do one thing, let's turn on this vehicle right away. It's going to make a lot of noise. Okay, the buttons here, lock, unlock, and I think this is for the alarm sounding thingy. Okay, let's turn on the car here. Oh my god, it turns on so easily. Look at this, I didn't even make any effort. I'm enjoying this. I need to do this more. Okay, here, that is like a one click starter. That's amazing. I loved it. Seats are very narrow at the front, don't offer much comfort at all. No comfort actually. Okay, on Mahindra's website it says it's got aux. Yeah, which it has got aux. It's got radio, which will play right away. Audio quality is really very poor, and it also says it's got Bluetooth connectivity, but I somehow could not find it. Now the glove box is very small, and again, I mean, there is a storage space here, handle to hold on to, no airbag for the co-passenger, airbag for the driver, because obviously what is mandatory is given. Let's remove the plastic peel here. Yeah, there's a lot of plastics. We can remove all of that because this is a brand new car. This has done how many kilometers? You guessed it right. This has done barely 800 kilometers when it came to me, actually 750 kilometers. Yet this car has a ton of vibrations and it kind of feels like it is aged a bit. In fact, I'll tell you another secret. You will be shocked when I tell you this. This car is the only car which also has an AquaGuard water filtering system for drinking water. Yeah, because water is leaking there. Can you see that? Yeah, water is leaking from the air conditioning on a brand new car, which is quite surprising to me. Let's remove more plastics because that is super satisfying. I mean, it takes a lot of effort, so I'll just remove them randomly and put them inside. Now, there's storage space here where Nurain has left her glasses. There's a 12 volt charging socket. There's no USB in this car. These are the controls for the air conditioning. Air conditioning vent. In fact, this also doesn't fit properly. It seems like an aftermarket thought. There are twin cup holders here in the center where I put my broken Ray-Bans. You can see the Ray-Bans are broken completely. Handbrake, and these are actually the power window controls. There's storage space here where I put a sanitizer, just for reasons I don't even know and understand. Steering wheel is just too big. The pedals down, they feel like that of a truck because they're so weirdly, like, ergonomics is not the cup of tea of this car. Let's use the wipers. Okay, it sprays so on the top. Now it's like it's cleaning the roof of the car, but wipers work decently well. There's no auto dimming inside rearview mirror. There is a mirror in the center, which is again a big thing, and this seems to be an aftermarket thought here, a mirror here. Obviously there's no mirror here, and you know what, seat belts obviously don't get the height adjust function, which is normal. You can't expect it either. Meanwhile, there's a mic placement here, which means Bluetooth should be there in this car. There's a light placement on the top, and there's actually good amount of headroom on offer at the front, but that's the only good part here. Okay, now this is actually the control for the headlights. This is for the wipers. There's a rear wiper which I will use right now. Yeah, there, sprays coming nicely, sprays quite a bit, but then you know you have to use the spray separately and the wiper separately as well. Now, what is good is it has this information system right here. Firstly, this is for, of course, the hazard light switch. Now, here it is telling me the time, which is wrong right now, gear position indicator and trip time. How much time you have driven the car, because I think this is used for cabs and cabs have this 8-hour thing now. So the person doesn't have to manually calculate it. You can just reset it and see it here, which is again cool. Okay, now we're just going to browse through this. Yeah, come on. Yeah, it's telling me the average fuel efficiency, which is 11.5 kilometers per liter. Distance to empty. So plenty of information, trip time and whatnot. So all this information you get here. Meanwhile, here again, it's a digital unit. This is actually the engine temperature. This is the fuel meter, and this is the tachometer, odometer, and a digital speedometer. And you can reset it like that. It says Bolero right here, just in case you forget which car you're sitting in. That is again a superb feature, really revolutionary inside this vehicle. But honestly, yeah, there's not much to talk about. This car is absolutely devoid of features. There is no feature as such inside this car. Yeah, you have to manually adjust this from the inside. That, for a car of this price, comes across as a big shock to me. Steering wheel gets no adjust at all. You can't adjust it for reach or rake. None of that happens either. Oh my god, a car costing so much is devoid of all sorts of features, and fit finish is also very poor. Quality levels are, I mean, kind of very on the bad side, because there are a lot of panel gaps everywhere. Fit finish is actually very poor. I don't know how Mahindra has been doing such a car when they're doing something as good as, say, the XUV as well as the Thar right now. Anyways, let's start driving right away. But before we start going, let me tell you something. It's got a feature known as co-driver detection system. That sounds like rocket science, but it's just that it's able to detect if there's a co-driver for the warning light or the sound which comes for the co-passenger seatbelt not worn. Now, the funniest thing is this thing, okay? Right now, what do you expect? This to be locked, right? When you put it inside, it should be locked. But it's actually open. They have done it the wrong way. Now, in order to lock the doors, this is how it locks. Yeah, that is just done the wrong way on this car. Very weird and difficult for me to grasp that. Let's get going right away. All right, we are all set to go, which means turning off the air conditioning, handbrake down into first gear, revving the motor. It revs still only slightly under 3000 rpm, and off we go. No wheel spin as such, and gearing is so short now. It does like 23 kilometers per hour in first gear, which is absolutely nothing. In fact, in second gear it does 58 kilometers per hour. So you're into third gear. Let's see how much it does in third gear. Okay, you can feel a lot of vibrations. Camera is vibrating, everything is vibrating. Yeah, this is a three-cylinder engine. It's a 1.5 liter unit. There's no top end in this car. Okay, it redlines at around 4000 rpm in third gear. It goes all the way till 91 kilometers per hour, 92 actually, into fourth gear, which will make it cross 100 kilometers per hour. In fact, 0 to 100 kilometers per hour takes around 20 seconds, making it very slow. This is a 1.5 liter three-cylinder engine. It's known as the MHawk 75. You know why genius? Because obviously it produces 75 horsepower, which comes in at 3600 rpm. Meanwhile, the torque output is a generous 210 newton meters, which comes in at a rather low 1600 rpm and stays there till 2200 rpm, giving it actually great drivability. So low end punch is absolutely fantastic. Mid range is also okay. It's actually good, but the top end is absolutely flat. There is no top end performance in this car. It struggles in the top end. Refinement levels by a three cylinder engine standards is actually pretty good, and even in the top end you can't hear much because you're busy hearing all the road noise, the tire noise, the wind noise and the vibrations and the metal clunking here and there. That's the reason you don't hear the engine at all. But top speed is actually 120 kilometers per hour. You can nudge 120 kilometers per hour, but you can actually go to almost 170 kilometers per hour, but down a cliff, of course. This engine has no performance for the size of this car. Into first gear, revving the motor. Yeah, power is channeled to the rear wheels, but no, the gearing is so short now. It struggles in first gear itself. I've never seen a car struggle so much in first gear. However, the good thing is the drivability is fantastic, which I'll show you in a bit. Now, the fuel economy of this car is around 15 kilometers per liter. It has got a 60 liter fuel tank as well, which is massive. And in order to improve the fuel economy of this car, it obviously has a stop start system as well, which is very, 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 very irritating. I hate it completely. The clutch is actually on the lighter side. The gearbox is not slick shifting. You have to sometimes push it here and there. It gets a 5-speed gearbox, of course. There's no automatic on offer. And there is another Bolero. Why do people buy so many Boleros? I will tell you in a bit. So this car is running a body on frame platform. Oh, little bit of wheel spin. Wow, Faisal, that is impressive. But you know, it dies out so fast in first gear, it's surprising and shocking. And I say that every time I launch the car. What's wrong with you, Faisal? Anyways, body on frame platform. At the front, we've got coil springs. At the rear, we've got leaf springs. Yeah, very old tech in terms of the suspension system. But you know what? The ride quality is actually decent when you're driving it in the city. When you're not driving fast, it's fine. The ride quality is fine and bearable. But once you start driving fast, now the car is all over the place. It has a lot of bounce. It wallows a lot here and there. And the ride quality is just not good enough because obviously it's leaf swing. But if you're on a full load, ride quality improves slightly. Actually, it improves quite a bit. But that said, this car doesn't even handle well, obviously, because the track is narrow. You're sitting high up. It has a high center of gravity. And it just rolls around the corner. There's so much roll. There are so many vibrations which you can feel. High speed stability is poor, but then it doesn't even reach high speed. So you can't really complain about high speed stability in this regard. And the steering doesn't really have much feel or feedback, but you know, it doesn't feel very loose either. So it's kind of predictable on that side. It's got dual channel ABS. What am I saying? It has got ABS actually. Anti-lock brakes, because that's mandatory. But still, braking performance isn't that impressive either. There is nose dive under heavy braking. So the dynamic package is very weak here. So ride is not good. Handling is not good. Steering feel is missing. Brakes are not that great. But then that's what you expect from a rural SUV, because this is rural in every regard. It just doesn't feel polished enough. It doesn't have to be, because that's what people like about this car. That's the reason why it sells. Why does it sell? You know what? You can get a TUV300 for the price of this car. Similar price. I mean, you might pay slightly more, because there are three variants available. There's the B4, B6 and the B6 option, which you're driving right now, which is priced at Rs. 10.7 lakhs on road Mumbai. The range actually starts at 9.55 lakhs, making it quite expensive for a sub 4 meter vehicle. But then there is monopoly of this car. You go to smaller towns, you go to Uttarakhand, all you will see is the Bolero in the taxi market, nothing else at all, because it is rugged, it is a body on frame platform, so it's able to take the beating very easily. And then of course the fact that it's very easy to repair as well, and that's the reason people are buying Boleros. It's actually selling in very good numbers. That's why Mahindra is like, we don't even need to change anything, however it is, we can keep selling it. But that said, you know what, there is a trick up its sleeve in terms of drivability, which I will show you in a bit. Now, whenever I get into the acceleration, I realize that for a 3-cylinder engine, this is fantastically refined. It's very smooth and very refined, because usually 3-cylinder engines are vibrating all over the place. But here, that is not really the issue as such. Only thing is, it doesn't like to be pulled in the higher end of the rev range. You need to short shift to drive this car. Flat out acceleration is not its mojo. It doesn't like being driven flat out. But then when you try to go flat out also, you know, it's moving so much all over the place that you're like, I should just stop the car and reduce the speed like what I've done right now and stopped it here. Hazard lights. Now I'll show you very interesting something, okay? Into fifth gear. I'm going to start from fifth gear. Who the F starts from fifth gear? Okay, I'll have to rev the motor a bit. We are off very slowly, very smoothly. I don't have to stall the car. In fifth gear, I'm revving the motor. Okay, just see this, okay? Who can actually take the car off in fifth gear? I can, because this car has so much, you know, drivability on offer. Now in fifth gear, I am flat foot on the ground, car is pulling. Just imagine picking a car from fifth gear, which means that you can easily drive this car in third gear in city driving conditions, in stop go traffic you can drive it in third gear. But now it's picking up the pace. This is the top gear of this car. Now all of a sudden, because mid-range, it has a nice pull, we are doing almost 114 kilometers per hour. We are actually going to reach the top speed of this vehicle. Yeah, that's 120 kilometers per hour. So yeah, from zero to top speed in one freaking gear. That is the level of drivability on offer from this Bolero, and that's the reason that people love it so much. Because when you're driving in a higher gear all the time, you're going to get better fuel economy, and right now I'm getting 15 kilometers per liter even though I'm driving it sedately. If you drive it even more sedately, you can actually get around 18 kilometers per liter as well. That's the reason why cab drivers who do not value their life love this car. It has only a driver's side airbag, it doesn't have an airbag anywhere else. That's kind of weird and awkward, and it's a very crude vehicle in that sense, something which is not refined. It feels overpriced for what it has to offer, but the powertrain package is actually quite good. Economy is good, it's rugged, it's easy to repair, and that's one of the reasons why the Bolero is such a popular vehicle. And that's not all, it's also popular because there are multiple variants of it. You can get a pickup truck and camper, blah blah blah, I don't even remember those things, but you can do a lot of those things as well. Now I'm just going to downshift. I'm being so stupid by driving it in, oh god, short gearing. I've already hit the red line in third gear, so we shift to fourth gear. Now you sit so high up, now you get a good view of what's around. You can see the bonnet, the mirrors, which have to be manually adjusted, kind of point to wherever they want to, so I don't really see what's around using the rear view mirrors. It's just pure anticipation of what could be around that could save the day. So guys, this is my vlog of the Mahindra Bolero. We are coming to a corner. I don't know if I'm going to make it straight, so I'm just going to end it. Okay, we're just going to drive, we're going to downshift to third gear and honk. You know, the horn doesn't sound at all. There's no sound of the honk. You press it, you think something is ringing, but it doesn't ring at all. That is how meek the horn is. And for a car which is aimed at cab drivers, thankfully they've given this amazing feature of the horn not sounding at all, so that less people get irritated out on the road. That said, it's still a car which is selling in good numbers purely because of the impression it has made, which makes me come to a life lesson. You know what? First impression could be the last impression. So whatever you do in life, make sure you do it right for the first time, so that people think you are really good at it. And that's the story of the Mahindra Bolero. Bye bye.